Live action, that's what I thought they meant, not like in really good animation.
Oh, yeah.
Because that to me doesn't scream live action because they're not real animals. It's not live. Because it's all CGI, you know, which is totally cool, but I just felt like it was not.
We're the only people in the world that probably shits on the new Lion King.
And like a red, white, and blue phoenix rising from the ashes of political bipartisanship, we are back to Salt of the Streets podcast.
This is Sunday, November 25th. 10:24 a.m.
Sunday. And on this beautiful Sunday, welcome back to Salt of the Streets podcast, your one and only source for social and political commentary on weekly news, pop culture, and sports built from the ground up for people like you and me, the everyday normal people around America.
Yeah.
Join us as we discuss life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, and continue our endless efforts to bridge the gap between people and information. As always, we are your hosts. I'm Colin.
I'm Donovan.
Coming up on this week's show, it's been almost 2 months since the alleged assassination of Saudi national and Washington Post contributor Jamal Khashoggi, and we have some pretty major breaks in the story that have come out this week, so we'll get you all caught up on the latest, and from there, we'll probably just kind of spin off into everybody's favorite topic, the Trumpy news,
yeah,
because there's never a shortage of that.
Trumpy things.
But of course, before we dive into the heavy stuff, just a reminder, take a second to rate and review the show on whatever platform you're on right now, whether it's SoundCloud, Stitcher, Apple, iTunes, podcast. If you like what we're doing and want to help us out, all you got to do is give us a rating and a review. Nice little 5 stars. Give us a little 30-second review. We'd love you forever, and it would greatly help out the show. Follow us on Instagram at Salt of the Streets. Give us a like on Facebook at Salt of the Streets. And also check out our weekly blog on saltofthestreets.com.
Everything on saltofthestreets.com.
And you'll find everything there as well.
Yeah.
Also, if you like the video podcast, you can find us on our Salt of the Streets YouTube channel. And of course, you can always reach out to us on our personal social medias. I am at Big Bird Offie on both the Twitters and the Instagrams.
And on Twitter, I am Salt of the Street. And on Instagram, I am alpaca_Donovan.
Of course you are.
Yeah.
I still love that. Now that I know the backstory behind alpaca.
It's just that much better, isn't it?
Yeah, it is so good. Because, I mean, I appreciated it when it was an animal. But now it's not an animal.
Mm-mm.
So if you missed the reference, go check out what was that, like a month or so ago?
That was 2 months ago? The episode that we did with Jake and Morgan.
Mm.
So whenever
was that on my birthday?
Yes.
Yeah.
So
that would have been, yeah, it probably came out like the 23rd or 24th of July.
Something like that.
Yeah.
So,
as you may notice, we're in a Studio Bravo over here at the Phillips household. We've got the nice Seahawks game on the back, so we might be having to check in with that.
Tied 0-0, 5:32 left in the first.
But if you missed the game this weekend and you're listening to this on Monday or Tuesday, we'll give you all the info right here.
Yeah.
So, Don, let's just jump into the old the updates on Jamal Khashoggi.
Okay. So, let's see. What do I have here? On November 16th, the Washington Post reported that the CIA had concluded their investigation on the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, and they had found that MBS Mohammed bin Salman, aka the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, who's kind of like his dad, the king, is still the acting ruler, but he kind of runs the day-to-day, like, bullshit and does all that. And so they found that Mohammed bin Salman ordered the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, and that there's no other, I mean, that's the only way that it could have been done, is if he would have done that. And they based that on two pieces of information, intercepted phone calls from Mohammed bin Salman the days before the murder, and then calls from the kill team to senior aides of Jamal Khashoggi, or of Mohammed bin Salman, after the murder happened.
Which I believe went to his brother. If I remember right.
I think so, yeah.
And then from there, it was like brother to
And they said him. In the phone calls, tell your boss that the deed is done.
Yeah.
You know what
I think
saying?
That's, I think the verbatim was tell the boss the deed is done.
Yeah.
And I mean, we have what's the quote? He specifically said to silence Jamal Khashoggi as soon as possible.
Yes.
Coming from MBS.
That is what Mohammed bin Salman said in those intercepted phone calls, right?
Mm-hmm.
And intercepted phone, I mean, that's for anybody who doesn't know. I mean, that means that there are phone calls that he made that the U.S. government was paying attention to, and they, you know, picked him up in the airwaves and decoded, and not decoded them because he's not speaking in code, he's speaking Arabic, and translated them from Arabic to English, and, you know, they found out that's what he said. That's
what the CIA does.
Yeah, pretty common practice through the government. And if you know anything about America, happens here all the time. But that's, we'll talk about that another time. And so that happened. And then on the 20th, and we'll get to this a little bit towards the end of this. On the 20th, the president put out a statement about the killing of Jamal Khashoggi that, again, directly contradicted the CIA with what they had found. And
this wasn't a... you know, Donald Trump jumping on his Twitter. This was an official statement from President Donald Trump.
It's on WhiteHouse.gov. Yeah, that's the one that I have his statement up here too. That is also, it is on WhiteHouse.gov. Briefings-statements/statement-president-donald-j-trump-standing-saudi-arabia. So. That's where this is.
As you started reading that, I looked up at the line. I was like, oh, this is going to be a long one.
As I kept going, I was like, how far should I go into
this? Did I make a mistake here?
But that's where you can find the statement itself. I mean, it's really, really easy to find. And they put it out, and there's a lot of really interesting shit here that I don't want to get into right now. We can talk a little bit about Khashoggi like as a deal. But we'll talk about this particular statement towards the end. But one thing I do think is important is, like I said, that President Trump has again directly contradicted the CIA, right? Because as you guys may or may not remember, but we talked about when the Helsinki deal went down, when President Trump went over and met with Putin over in Helsinki, right? Before that, the CIA, all of the intelligence communities as a whole, what is there, 16 of them or something like
Something like that.
They all collectively agreed and came together to say that the Russians did, in fact, interfere with the election, right? And that is not me saying that they swayed the election because they didn't, right? That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying, and as we've said 1,000 times before, is that the Russians undoubtedly, unquestionably, nothing at all, they had their hands in the election, right? And like we said, they didn't. We're talking about a pie, right? They didn't piss in the pie. They didn't shit in it. They didn't put hairs in it. They did nothing, but they put their hands in it.
Yeah, you know? They touched it.
They had their hands were clean to begin with. You know, they had washed them, but after they washed them, they just put their hands in your pie and then took it out and walked away.
You know what I'm saying? I was a little iffy on this pie analogy. But you got me on board.
That's what I'm saying.
You got me on board.
So I'm saying I made sure they wash their hands first so that, like, their hands are clean. But they just, like, how you feel, you know, it doesn't feel good to know that somebody, even though they're clean hands, they're just all up in your pie, you know.
And, I mean, nobody's hands are ever truly clean, right?
Exactly.
But, yeah, I mean, this is what we talked about, like, the fake news campaigns that went on. And
yes.
And a lot of that was driven by, you know, Russian actors.
Yeah.
You know, they meddled, I think that's the best word. They meddled.
Yeah. And we talked about those postings, too, kind of probably around the time that Zuckerberg testified in front of the Senate.
Yeah.
It's probably when we talked about this, right? That it, again, undoubted, unquestionably, right? Anybody who disagrees, you're wrong. That's not my opinion. That's not anything. You're wrong. Factually, you're incorrect. The fact of the matter, right, the truth of the matter is the Russians did spend $100,000 on Facebook, I believe that it was, like a little over $100,000 in ads on Facebook and on promoting things, right, that was bullshit, right? But
real fake news.
But again, when it comes down to it, that's up to you. You know, if you found any of that information and you believed it and you didn't double check the sourcing, that's on you. Right. That's not on Russia. That's not on whatever. It's not right. I don't think that they should be buying political ads here, but that's not the argument that swayed the election in favor of President Trump, I think, is disingenuous. Right. And it takes the personal responsibility out of the things that people read on a day to day, you know, because, well, I don't know. That's it. It takes the personal responsibility out. And I think that's bullshit. You are 100% responsible of the information that you take in and that you believe.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And whether or not you double check it, that's on you.
And it's a sad state of affairs when we can't reliably count on like one source all the time.
Yes. Except this
one. But this is Facebook we're talking about.
Except this one. You can count on us.
100%.
This shouldn't be the only place where you get your news. We've said that before. But as we've also said, we do our damnedest to make sure that the information we're providing to you is factual, and anything we're incorrect about, we'll generally slap a little fact check on that. And on Tuesday, I come around to it. So most of the time, if you're listening to this and you have found something, you're like, I'm not sure that that's true, go check my Twitter, because I probably talked about it. You know what I'm saying?
Do you hashtag fact check when you do
that? I do. I thought so. Hashtag correction tweet. That's what it is.
Correction
tweet. Hashtag correction tweet every time. So you can even look up the hashtag correction tweet, and it's probably mostly my tweets. You know what I'm saying? Because it's just an uncommon hashtag.
Because whenever I need to fact check something that I say, I just say fact check and Dom looks it up for me.
I've got that time on Tuesdays. Thank you to my bosses.
Well, there was... Nah, I won't bring that up. There was a side note there that I think we might touch on later, but we'll get to... If we get to that, we'll get there.
Yeah.
It had to do with like fake news and people reading things off of Facebook, like whether or not Black Friday is racist. Because I've heard a lot of misinformation about that, but I'll put that in the grab bag. We'll save that for later if we get to it.
Yeah.
Just please know Black Friday is not racist.
So as we were kind of alluding to, right, when it comes to the president contradicting the CIA, you know, just like he did in Helsinki, that's how we got on this, right? And he was asked about it then that he said, oh, well, you know, President Putin or Vladimir Putin told me, you know, that he didn't do it. You know, when I looked at him face to face, he told me that he didn't do it. And he's saying the same thing now with Mohammed bin Salman, that, oh, well, he's told me several times that he didn't have anything to do with it, you know, and I believe him. Like, and I think that that's a serious, serious problem to have a president that, what do I have here, right? Then he's believing the heads of state over the intelligence community, right? I mean, and that shows either like no care or concern for the role or the responsibility of the intelligence agencies.
Yeah.
I mean, that's their whole job, is there to look into those things and tell you, because you're the president, you don't have the time or the resources outside of the intelligence communities to do that.
That's why they exist, and that's why they're extensions of the executive branch of government.
Those are your intelligence communities. Those are your resources. You know, if your resources are telling you that this is the case, why would you believe anything other than that? You know, that doesn't make any sense. Like, that's...
Because, again, this man has no concept of how the governmental system is supposed to run.
Yeah.
He sees whether you're on his side or not on his side. And I can understand somebody in a position like the presidency where you want to, how do I say, especially with gesundheit, Jordan. With somebody like Saudi Arabia, for example, like Russia, I can still understand, but you want to make sure that whatever you do as a diplomat for the country, because you are representing the country that you have been elected for, that you want to, you know, you want to play nice with everybody you can. You want to have good relationships and all this stuff. But it's all surface type of stuff.
Right.
And then you should still rely and make decisions based off of your own, you know, intelligence community, for example, in this case. But the problem is when the way Donald Trump does it, he shits on the intelligence community when they don't necessarily play his way.
Yes.
And... You know, and then I think he still has a lot of emotional ties to this supposed witch hunt that he calls it.
Yeah.
You know, and so his kind of breakdown.
So you think he sees connections between his witch hunt and what's going on here with
NDS? Well, yeah, he said all the time with, it's just the intelligence communities.
Yeah.
In general.
Just like, the intelligence
communities. Yeah, because he said over and over through this Mueller thing that, like, the FBI is biased and all this stuff.
Right.
And, you know... That's not a good, you can't say that as a president.
Right.
You're now, what's the term I'm looking for? But you're pulling any credibility away from your own intelligence agencies.
Like just discrediting them? Is that what you're looking
for? Yeah, because he will go out and say something that directly contradicts them.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, no, I mean, you got to believe me because I'm the president.
Because I'm the president.
But you're not, you're supposed to say what they say because they speak for you because they are an arm of your branch of government.
Right. And so I can definitely understand, like you were saying, I can understand why he would maybe not be boldly, openly, publicly aggressive towards MBS, right? Because mm-hmm. he is the president, has to kind of save face.
But you don't do this.
Yeah. Because like you said, it discredits the intelligence communities that now you are telling America they can't believe the people that are supposed to be looking out for them.
You know, we use the softball analogy a lot, right? Well, this is the equivalent of the coach of the team going out to the umpire or something like that, who is ideally the world, and you're, you know, speaking in the microphone to the rest of the, you know, the stadium and saying like, hey, don't, you know, we don't listen to these guys. These guys suck. You know, yeah, they're my team, but I don't, you know, don't listen to them. And it's, you can't do that, man. What kind of coach is that?
And it's unfortunate, right? Because you have, with how divisive the country is right now, there are so many individual citizens that are ride or die for Donald Trump that they are willing to accept and believe that statement that, oh, well, the FBI is corrupt then and the CIA is corrupt and they all have it out for President Trump anyway. Yeah. You know, President Trump nothing matters anymore. Exactly. President Trump is the only person that I can believe because he's telling me that, you know, he's got us this far. He's done all this stuff. You know, he's bringing back my coal jobs and, you know, he's fucking around in the Middle East and he told North Korea to go fuck themselves. And
I mean,
you know,
he got us hundreds of thousands of jobs from this Saudi weapons deal.
Yeah. So
right, wink, wink.
So it,
there's so many things wrong with it.
Like horrible, horrible, not even coincidence, right? Just like, I don't know, circumstance isn't the right word either, you know, but like a chance almost, you know, just chance that all of these things are lining up in such a way, you know, that he is able to say these things and not be shit on, for lack of a better term, by the majority of the country, but to have so many people be like, that's my man.
Yeah.
You know, that's my boy right there.
And where does like, that come from?
That's twisted. That is fucking twisted that people have allowed themselves to get to a point. Okay. So let me tell you this. So one of the moments this week where I could have been playing Red Dead Redemption, but only had 30 minutes. So I read a book instead, right? So I'm reading Jordan Peterson. Okay. And he's talking about times where you have to say no, but say yes, mm-hmm. right? And he's like, there are a lot of times where you, like, you need to say no, but instead, you know, for whatever reason, you just say yes, you know? And he's like, can you do that enough times? You eventually lose your ability to say no when you have to say no, you know? And so then he says, this is exactly how you get Nazi Germany. It says you have masses of people that see tiny things, one person, one Jewish person being taken out of their house. And they're like, well, it's not that big of a deal. It's one person, you know? Yeah, and then shit like that keeps happening. And you've said yes enough times that now when you're at a point where you're seeing people be murdered in the street because they're Jewish, you're like, what am I going to do?
Well, there's a reason, you know, for that.
And that's like
trying to justify it or something.
And I am not, because anybody who's too devout to Trump would be like, this guy's calling Trump Hitler. This guy's saying Trump is a Nazi, and that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that Hitler and Trump are the same person. I'm not saying that Trump is Hitler reincarnated. I'm not saying that people who support Trump are Nazis, right? It's the same idea that we talk about with leftists and with this crazy socialism bullshit with the 75 gender identifiers. These same people who will say that I'm trying to say that Trump is a Nazi will say that that's bullshit, right?
Yeah.
It's the same idea. The same way that idea and the idea of socialism are the same, are hand in hand, right? This, what he's doing, what is going on in that wing of the Trump party is totalitarianism. Like that, like that's on the road there, man. And that's not the groupthink nastiness where you're unable to get away from that is what's going on. And that is unhealthy.
Well, see, that
dangerous.
As you say, totalitarianism, right? Totalitarianism implies force. Correct?
I mean,
like, this is
because,
like,
these same people, I say that because these same group of people is that are willing to say Trump forever, right? It's like that far right part that are willing to throw down in Charlottesville and shit like they did. You know, that's that same group of people. Like, and that's the small tip of that iceberg, you know? But you have that group of people traveling around to different towns doing shit like that.
You know? I like that the way you phrase that as an iceberg, because that is like that sharp tip at the very edge.
Yes.
But then it goes down and then you have the more, the broader base, if you will.
Absolutely.
That aren't a bunch of nationalists, racist, whatever.
And I absolutely agree with that. And that is why I put it that way.
So just using that, because it doesn't really matter. It's kind of whatever. But just using your definition of totalitarianism.
Yeah.
Like, how many people are just voluntarily being, a follower of this always Trump syndrome or something like that? And why? Is it just one part of his message that gets under their skin and that's the one thing that they really they ride or die on, and they're just passionate enough about, building a wall or, trade, or I don't know what it is, or if it's just his personality in general.
I kind of think I went over that a couple weeks ago when we were talking about the migrant caravan, right? Mm-hmm. We're talking about immigration, because for a lot of people, immigration is their deal, right? And so I think one of the big examples I kind of thought of were the people who what do I got here?
And the people that, what is it, like the
people that have like the tradesman's jobs, people that work in like the coal mines and shit like that, right? That come from the generation where they had to work hard and had shitty jobs, right? Mm-hmm. They're watching people of our generation not want to have shitty jobs. You know, like we were talking about with Dave last week. They don't want trades. They don't want to do nothing in the fucking fields. They don't want to do anything like that, you know? And so they see immigrants coming here, taking those jobs, right?
They took our jobs!
In reality, accepting those jobs because other people are not willing to take them, right? Yeah. And that's what's happening. And so then you see all these people that are, that are working hard, and you're seeing Americans be lazy and all this shit, and now you got problems with immigrants when it's not really their problem. They're just coming here to take the work because they need work. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's people like that are that do draw conclusions that really don't make any sense. Mm-hmm. I think that's that same group of people, because they're able to look past all of this crazy shit that President Trump says, as he's just being strong. He's strong-arming North Korea and he's strong-arming Russia, and look where mm-hmm. we're at. We're doing all right,
But I think a lot of the Trump base probably gets a bad rap, because I feel like their views, for whatever reason, why they support Trump, are so diverse.
Well, right. And that's just one.
It's so hard to pin down.
The particular example that I laid out is not by any means the entirety of the Trump base. That's just one path that I can see for somebody who is a totally normal, reasonable American to be getting to a point where they're they're supporting someone like President Trump, who's sane and crazy, doing unreasonable, unlogical shit,
And that's, so to kind of bring it back to
the illogical,
Khashoggi,
illogical.
The Khashoggi.
Yeah. Khashoggi.
Yeah. I don't know how you do that. did you buy hats by chance?
Buy hats?
On that? Yeah. Buy hats. Do you buy hats? Oh, speaking of which, side note, remind me to talk to you about hats after the show.
Okay.
On that Washington Post article, did you watch that video?
I did not.
Oh, man. They break down the known timeline of the assassination from when the teams left, the hit teams. There's three different teams that went out, when they got there, what they did, who they were. And it's pretty intense.
The first time we covered this a couple episodes ago, that would be episode 36, when we first talked about this.
Dang.
I went over a rough timeline through a BBC article of that same type of idea of when they arrived, when they got to the consulate, when they did all this stuff, and then when they left. And it was all within 12 hours or some shit. I mean, even smaller than a really tiny window that they arrived, murdered him, cut him up, buried him, and then left.
Yeah. And it sounds like they, from everything I've read through here, and it's hard because this is a CIA report that got, it was essentially a report that the president was briefed on. And so we're never going to see that report.
Okay. So it was
all we have is, from sources, knowledgeable of the report or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's hard to pin down the actual facts. But from everything I'm looking for, cross referencing all the articles, the facts that we, you know, the quote unquote facts that we do know seem to all run true.
Yes.
But it sounds like he was essentially dissolved. What's that word? Is it 21 Cloverfield Lane? Or, what movie was that? That Cloverfield movie, the latest one. But dissolved in...
The Paradox?
No. Oh, yeah. So not the newest one. The one with John Goodman.
Yeah, that's 10 Cloverfield
Lane. 10 Cloverfield Lane. You know how they go up into the attic and they pop that lid on that barrel or something and there's like the freaking... The body dissolving in like acid and stuff.
Word.
That's from my understanding how his body was disposed of.
Okay. So I remember when it first happened, they were talking about him being buried.
Like up in the ground. Forest or something, right?
They talked about, I heard in the forest, and then I also heard on the grounds of the Saudi Arabian consular, like the consul. They went to his house.
Yeah, because they did go to his house.
And so they had thought that he was buried on the grounds of the consul's home of Saudi Arabia. Ooh. But now it sounds, you're saying, it sounds like he was dissolved in acid.
From everything I read, that's the sound. But at the end of the day, we really don't know. We won't know, and 100%.
We may never know exactly what happened to him. There were 70 people who were sanctioned in, like, dealing with this. And so if some type of trial or something goes down, some people are going to be put to death, right? In Saudi Arabia, is that the case? That so unless there's some type of hearing or trial or something, I don't know that we'll ever get that information from them, because the Saudis aren't going to request it because they're the ones that had this done, you know? So the amount of investigating the Saudis are going to do into this is going to be very, very limited.
Yeah, that's I was happy that the CIA's report had come out, because up to date, for the most part, all the information we've been getting is from Turkish news. And half, if not more, of the Turkish news outlets are state-owned these days.
Really?
And so you're just kind of getting, you know, the Turkish government's news. Yeah. You know, there's a couple things. I got an article in here from, what's it called? The Hurriyet Daily News, which is a Turkish outlet, but it's not, I don't believe it's state-run.
Hurriyet.
But it it references the CIA report and the phone calls and stuff that Gina Haspel has listened to.
Ooh,
head of Haspel. CIA these days.
The shift from the consul.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was the one that listened to these phone calls.
And President Trump said he wasn't going to listen to him, right?
Yeah, because he was just going to get briefed by the CIA. Which ideally is...
If I was the president, and this is just part of my like weird fucked up true murder podcast.
Yeah, I would say you would love that.
I would be like, let me hear those fucking tapes. Like, let me hear the tapes. Let me see the fucking tapes. Like, I want this fucking information now.
You're like, hang on. I got to call Jeff Sesh real quick. And I got to see if I, as the president, can create a podcast with Wondery about this.
I want to see if I, can, right? if I can go ahead and call the guy from fucking Sword and Scale and see if I can get something worked out.
Oh, that's fun.
I would love to be on another outpost or on another, you know, podcast.
Oh, for sure.
What the fuck am I talking about?
But I mean, by then you're president anyways, Don. How much more can you ask for?
Yeah. Maybe I just want to talk about it on TV, you know.
Yeah, right.
Just let me get a little bit of airtime.
I was like, come on, guys. It's 2018. We got the president is all over the Twitter machine. Let him get a podcast going. I want a White House
podcast. I want a presidential podcast.
Yeah.
From the fucking Oval Office. Every month.
Definitely.
That would be kind of rad.
I want Barack Obama to host an interview podcast show.
Barack.
That would be insane.
That would be really good.
Just, I mean, say what you want about the man, but he has a wonderful voice to listen to.
He does.
You know.
He's a great orator.
I'm not a huge fan of the way he governed or some of his politics, but I like to listen to him talk.
He's
a
great public speaker.
He is.
Great public speaker.
Mm-hmm. This beer is really good.
It's super good.
We didn't mention it. Shout out to Downpour Brewing, Kingston.
It's a 32-ounce beer.
Yeah, it's really cool, man. If you guys are watching the video, you could see this giant can of beer. And I went there the other day, and I asked if they, you know, because a lot of breweries, they sell like 22-ounce bottles and stuff like that. But they don't sell any bottles. But she goes, you know, the I don't know if you want to call her a bartender, but the person behind pouring the taps.
The tap lady?
Yeah, the tap lady. She said, no, but we sell cans. I was like, oh, okay. She's like, yeah, they're the size of a squeaker.
A squeaker.
Which is a 32-ounce can. It's a lot of beer.
We got two perfect glasses of beer.
Yeah, perfectly filled pint glasses. It was magical.
Yeah.
And but yeah, it was like super cheap, and it was the coolest thing in the world. They just take this can, they sanitize it real quick, they fill it up like they do a growler. They take a lid and they put it in this little machine, and like a minute and a half later, you got a nice cold carbonated beer in a can that'll last 2-3 weeks before it's open.
You said this is in Kingston?
Yeah, right downtown.
Should be going there.
It's...
They serve food there?
No, but the Grub Hut is right next door.
Mm.
So I'm sure that you can make an arrangement. And but yeah, it was a nice place, man. We'll have to go.
Yeah.
Because I've never been there before.
I like this a lot.
I've heard not so awesome things about it.
Really?
But when I went there, I was like, this is actually pretty nice. They got a nice, like, real, you know, dark wood kind of feel. It's real warm and, you know, kind of cozy.
Really like this enormous can.
It's so cool.
This is really kind of cool.
And you can recycle it.
And I would love to just carry one of these around, you know.
It's a big can.
In a brown paper sack.
It's good for guys with big hands like us.
I need one of these in a brown paper sack, you know, that I can just...
Yes. Like the... is it just me, or every time I go to the weed store, I always walk out with a little brown paper sack?
Always a brown paper bag, yeah.
Yeah. It's very interesting. So I think from there we could probably pivot into the
old statement.
The statement.
Okay, so there was a couple of problems that I had with this statement, right?
I got so many problems with this statement.
Yeah. So one of the quotes that I pulled from it is here. We'll start towards the top, right? Now, one of the things that he said, see, he had talked to Jamal Khashoggi many times, right? Our intelligence agencies. This is a quote from. Let's see, like the fifth paragraph, I think. Our intelligence agencies continue to assess all information, but it could be very well that the Crown Prince had knowledge of this tragic event. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. Exclamation point.
Yeah. Right?
But I don't know. Like, why is that good enough for you? You know, why? Well, maybe he did, maybe he didn't. Like, why is that good enough? Why is that okay? You know?
Yeah.
That doesn't seem
in a... In a true diplomat's way, if this was a proper president, the sentiment would be, because I think he's speaking towards the kind of the public outcry to the deals that we've made with Saudi Arabia lately and our relationship with Saudi Arabia. And
which is trash, which we went over in the Khashoggi thing and
yeah.
In the fucking... when we talked about the problem with Yemen a couple episodes back, we went over all this bullshit and how I think that we should not be involved with Saudi Arabia at all.
Yeah. But the problem is, for whatever reason, you know, there's multiple reasons, but Saudi Arabia, the kingdom of Saudi Arabia, is a very important strategic ally, right? And we talked about this, like you said, on that Yemen show. And there's a lot of reasons why we can't just necessarily completely alienate them without consequences.
Because that's who we got.
Right? Because that's kind of one... Yeah, it's one of the only people we got over there besides Israel. And, you know, so from... Like I said, from a standard, halfway decent diplomatic president, you would not want to just... come out and start, you know, condemning them over and over again, really nailing them down, hardening them down. You would want to publicly condemn them, but then, you know, and take like sanction action or something like that. But you would want
to cancel the active contracts that you have with them.
That would be a good place to start. Yeah. Especially because what was it? $100-some billion or like a total of $450 billion worth of trade deals.
And then 110 on military equipment. Right.
Yeah.
And they've only purchased a fraction. I might have it written down here, but they've only purchased a fraction of that $110 billion of weapons. Like, they haven't filled that contract yet.
It's like a long-term agreement that they will meet over a period of time.
Yeah, but I think that it's even less than, at this point, than we expected. I'm trying to...
Yeah, I would probably argue, just without even looking at the number, it's got to be at definitely under 100,000. Or 100 billion.
Yeah.
Because that's close to the totality of it all.
Yeah, I don't have fact check. I'll try and find that because I did hear something about that.
Because it's been what? A little over a year?
Something like that. I think so.
Yeah. And I mean, there can't be too much money there. But again, I think this is him doing a really bad job at trying to just not directly point a finger and say, bad, we're going to, you know, we're going to rock our relationship now. But the problem is he has no idea how to do that.
Right.
And so his only, you know, this is just, this sounds like it was dictated into that, you know, a writing dictation program from a speaker or something like that. Because it sounds like him.
It seems to me, right? Because I understand, as much as I don't like how it feels, right? Because I don't personally, I understand that you can't just be like, you know what, NBS, fuck you. You know, fuck Saudi Arabia, we're out of here. Like, you can't be doing this shit like this, we're over it, right?
Some,
I understand
some deep geopolitical implications.
But it seems like the easiest thing that you could do, you know, is be like, listen, we're sanctioning these 17 people that we know had something to do with it. We're pretty certain that you had something to do with it. So we're going to go ahead and withdraw this weapons contract. We're not doing this shit anymore, right? Because not only is that a strike that you need to have towards the crown, right? Mm-hmm. But it also deals with this Yemen bullshit that you got yourself into that so many people have a problem with, right?
Oh, and dude.
So, I mean, it's like a dual purpose deal that it's a hit towards the crown. It deals with Yemen, and it also is like an olive branch towards the Democrats that you're like, also, I don't really want to do this either. So let's work something out, you know?
Yeah. I
like,
mean, I think, go ahead.
No, that's it. That's it. Now that's all I gotta say.
Yeah. I'm thinking like in my mind, if I was the president here, and I want to try to maintain geopolitical relations, you know, keep this strategic alliance in place and still do kind of the moral right thing. Like you said, I think first off, you would have to, you know, we sanctioned the 17 individuals that we believe were involved.
Sorry, everybody.
I would have a public condemnation of the Crown Prince based off of our, you know, our intelligence information.
Yeah.
And I would demand a, you know, like a withdrawal from Yemen. And I would make sure that there are consequences because we have to remember, we, regardless of how much power they have and control over things like the economy based on the oil prices and all that, no, they don't hold us hostage anymore.
No.
We are the number one producer of oil in the world.
Well, and we would
that was something we fact checked from his speech. I think it was in here somewhere.
Well, and there's enough people around the world producing oil besides the Saudis that's not the only place that we can go to get oil.
No.
You know what I'm saying?
And even if the entire OPEC, you know, cartel decides to jack the prices up on oil.
What does OPEC stand for?
OPEC is the...
Do you have it down somewhere?
I do have it pulled up. It's a mouthful.
Just because people might not know
what OPEC is. Yeah, because you hear it talked a lot about, especially these days, because Donald Trump likes to focus on the economy so much.
Yeah,
you'll see the organization of petroleum exporting countries, Word. OPEC. And, you know, surprisingly, the member states involve Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Venezuela. They were the original founders of it. And then now I believe it has 9 additional members, including Qatar, Indonesia, Libya, United Arab Emirates, Algeria, Nicaragua, my wife's very own Ecuador, Gabon, and Angola. And so those are the countries that make up the oil cartel that is OPEC.
Yeah.
But anyways, they control essentially the price for oil worldwide.
Yes.
Because they're the lead exporters. The U.S. is now the lead producer of oil, but we don't export that much.
And the way that was kind of explained to me the first time, I don't remember who it was, but that when gas prices kind of like skyrocket for a little bit and they go back down, right? Mm-hmm. That's because everybody in OPEC has kind of decided that we're all going to sell oil for like the same price.
Right? Yep.
We're all going to sell for the same price. So, you know, it keeps the market even, right? But every once in a while, someone's like, you know what, I'm going to cut my barrels by like 50 cents,
mm-hmm.
you know, or some shit like that. And so someone will buy a whole fuckload of oil from that country instead, and it sets everything off and freaks everybody out. And then our gas prices go up really high and then they come back down.
Yeah.
You know, because after they do that, everybody in OPEC takes notice and they're like, hey, what the fuck? You can't do that. Like, we got this whole thing going on, you know? So they're like, oh, right. And they figure it back out and it levels back out, you know?
Yeah. And Saudi Arabia is so important in this context because they are, when it comes to OPEC, they're the big dog in OPEC.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there is a true...
Always had hell oil.
Yeah. I mean, there is a logical reason to kind of want to play nice with, you know, Saudi Arabia when it comes to oil prices. Because they could do what they did back in this, what was it, 70s with the massive gas shortage and the line when they just spiked the oil or just stopped doing whatever. You know, that's a real problem that could pop up. But the thing is, we're not exactly reliant on them. We don't have to be anymore.
Right.
It's a different world. And so, crap, what was the point I was trying to make? I got sidetracked.
OPEC,
oil, Saudi Arabia, Yemen.
Don't need them.
Like, because we, you know, like I said, as the United States, we can make a demand of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and they can't necessarily hold oil over our heads anymore.
Right.
They could try, and it might be rough for a minute, but we could figure it out. I mean,
would be all right.
Yeah, we'd be all right. We're the number one producing oil company in the world now. I mean, or country in the world. We can handle it if we needed to.
It's just a big company.
Yeah, just a big company. That's all it is.
That's what President Trump thinks.
Yeah. And that there lies the problem, my friend. But yeah, I did have about that same statement you talked about. Our intelligence agencies continue to assess all information, but it could very well be that the Crown Prince had knowledge of the tragic event. Maybe he did. Maybe he didn't. Exclamation point. But I wrote in there, in my little notes there, according to reports, the CIA report specifically points to a phone call implicating the Crown Prince as the ultimate authority in carrying out the extrajudicial killing. And so what I did is I went ahead and I copy pasted that entire speech into my writing program.
Yeah.
And it lets me highlight things with different colors. Ooh. And so I went around and highlighted, you know, actual true statements, whether or not they actually have anything to do with anything. I highlighted them in yellow, stuff that's kind of shady or I don't fully think is truthful in the way that he, you know, when compared in proper context, I flagged in orange, and then I have some things flagged in red.
Some things that are half-true.
That are basically just bullshit. And that was one of my red lines. That whole thing where he just blatantly contradicts. He just questions the authority of the intelligence community right off the bat.
Yeah.
He says, well, maybe he did, maybe he didn't. No, like, now you're just, you're peeing all over the report.
Yeah.
You're peeing all over everything the CIA just did.
When he tried to lie about it, you know, like when he was being asked about it, he was like, oh, you know, they didn't really find that. Like they just had kind of, you know, general ideas of whatever. I'm like, that's not the case. Like, yeah. And if you're saying that, there's going to be that same group of people we were talking about that aren't going to do their due diligence, which is their own fault. Mm-hmm. You know, but you know that they're not going to go and look it up because you're telling them that it's wrong.
Yeah, I mean, truthfully, we know that there's going to be a large percentage of the population that just doesn't have the time or they just don't care enough to actually find the truth.
Yeah.
And when there's a wealth of misinformation, especially coming from the head of state, that's just – it's so dangerous on so many levels. It's just yet another – institution that should be relied upon that now you're casting shade on.
Yeah.
And it the true implications of that are far reaching down to, you know, probably a value that I think a lot of the Trump base carries, and that's probably just mistrust in all institutions.
Yeah.
As, you know, as pertaining to government anyways. So I did have one other – since I talked about my red lines, I want to talk about this one other line.
I have another one too.
About – I put it when – it's the third paragraph in, and he talks about having heavy negotiations with Saudi Arabia last year. They're agreeing to spend $450 billion in the United States, and he said it will create hundreds of thousands of jobs. And okay, first off, it's not the federal government's job to create jobs, period.
No.
It's not. It's to make sure that there's no
– God damn it.
What's the word? Roadblocks, I guess, to creating jobs. And, you know, especially it's not the federal government's jobs to create jobs in the military-industrial complex. And that's a thing that I think both you and I are pretty passionate about.
Military-industrial complex?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't...
Shout out to Eisenhower, baby.
That's the... I mean, it's one thing for that to exist, but if your sole client is the federal government, That's essentially a state-sponsored industry.
Well, I think that
if you think about it,
I think it's really easy to draw the connection, not draw the connection, but to see that that's how President Trump sees this country, is that the military is the way to make money. You know, that's what we need to focus on, is the military is the most important thing. And if he had it up to, if it was up to President Trump, that's what would be going on. We've seen it even as much as the last 2 years that he has gone on Thanksgiving to National Guard posts and talked about the brand of the military, the brand of the National Guard. You know, the brand is doing all of this. The military is not a fucking brand. You know what I'm saying? That's not how it's supposed to be.
It's not supposed to be.
No, that's not how it's supposed to be. Like, that's
a problem in and of its own. However you say that. But that was another red line that I think. And I, you know, another point I wanted to hit was, you know, there is absolutely no conceivable way that these contracts would create hundreds of thousands of jobs. It's patently absurd to think.
No, that it's not going to increase the jobs at those places, because they're already Lockheed and, Boeing and Raytheon. Yeah, Raytheon, that's what it is. They're just going to keep doing what they're doing.
Yeah. Like, they might expand a little bit. You never know. But
it's not going to double the size of their company.
No. That's, like I said, it's patently absurd to say that. It's a complete and utter lie. It's bullshit, but it sounds good. But we're going to create jobs.
Weird. And that's been his whole thing this whole time, right? He's going to create more jobs. And we talked about this again. We talked about this just a couple weeks ago, that the big problem with that is that the unemployment rate is low as shit. Lowest in a really, really long time, you know, but wages, they have risen a little bit, but they're still not rising. You know what I'm saying? Yep. Wages are largely still stagnant, you know? That's the problem here. It's not that, because you can have three jobs, but if you're making $7 an hour at all three jobs, you're still not making very much money.
Now, you know? what's a $7 an hour wage after taxes?
It's dick.
Like five?
It's dick.
Five and a half, maybe?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not much.
No.
Because, I mean, you got to think it's about 18 to 20%. At least in our state, and that's not, you know, and that's without a state income tax, for God's sakes.
Yes.
20? I mean, just imagine that. It's like a good basis that I run. I think it's a little less than 18, depending on what industry you're in. If you're somebody that has to pay into like an L&I program, that costs a little bit more.
Yeah.
Because you're buying into essentially your own private insurance fund. But, you know, it comes out to roughly 18% of your paycheck is taxed strictly on the federal and state level. But yeah, so that's, yeah, I guess that's all I wanted to hit.
I got another one here, right? Then again, this is a direct quote from this statement that he said here. I'll pull it up so I can try and give it a little bit more reference, because I don't want to totally...
Don't want to freeball it all the way?
Yes. I don't want to mischaracterize it. I want it to be exactly what it is, right?
Panthers are up 10-3.
Horrible. This is after he says, our intelligence agencies continue to assess all information, but it could be very well that the Crown Prince had knowledge of this tragic event. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. Next paragraph. That being said, we never know all the facts surrounding the murder of Mr. Jamal Khashoggi. In any case, our relationship is with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's my fucking problem with that, right? Here's my fucking problem with that, right? When Hitler's in power, should we continue to do business with Germany? Because, well, you know, our shit's with Germany, not with Hitler. Like, that's who our business is with. When Stalin is in power, when fucking Putin is in power in Russia, should we continue to do business with Russia? No, we don't. You know what I'm saying? We don't. For that same fucking reason. That is bullshit.
It is.
That feeds into that same totalitarianism that I was talking about, you know? Well, as long as they're, you know, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who's leading the country.
It would be one thing if it was a Western democracy, because you could agree with, say, let's say Prime Minister Theresa May. Her and Trump could have a great relationship.
She's not running that whole country.
Exactly. Yes. She's an elected official who is a representative of the nation. They're not a monarch. They are not the, you know, in this case, mind you, it's not MBS, Crown Prince, but realistically it is.
Yes.
You know, technically it's the king who is the monarch of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
Specifically when it comes to the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, we know that it had to do with him. Yeah. We know that it was him.
Yeah, you
know,
and this is why I threw that statement in orange, because in proper context, if it was a different situation, that statement would be true.
But not
in this case, because in an absolute monarch, the monarch is the nation.
Yeah.
And so in this case, it's, again, I used the word earlier, it's patently absurd. It doesn't, there's, our relationship as United States is with the Saudi royal family, because they are indeed the nation itself, because it's an absolute monarch.
Well, and we also talked about, I think when we talked about Yemen, the connections between Jared Kushner and Mohammed bin Salman, right? And just how sketchy that is. And The Intercept reported when MBS was on his tour of America that Jared Kushner shared some classified information with Mohammed bin Salman from one of the daily briefings from President Trump's, from one of President Trump's daily briefings. And then after that, somebody quoted Mohammed bin Salman from saying that Jared Kushner is in his pocket.
Yeah.
You know, you have the person who is the head, who is spearheading peace in the Middle East, is said to be in the pocket of Mohammed bin Salman, who just murdered somebody, who's writing articles about him in the fucking Washington Post.
Yeah. Some Putin level, assassinating dissident.
You know, you have all of these things coupled with, like I said, the president being, oh, well, that's all right. Because either way, you know, we're not dealing with Mohammed bin Salman. We're dealing with Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
And that's what really matters. But this is the guy that's also said to be spearheading all these new liberal campaigns there. You know, oh, we're going to let ladies drive, you know, and we're going to let them go to sporting events. And, you know, they can do this and they can do that, you know. But keep your fucking mouth shut in the newspaper.
Yeah.
You know, I just... That's ridiculous. And we have a president who is sitting there saying this is okay. You know, that's all right. Because at the end of the day, we're not dealing with him.
Well, yeah, because in my mind, you know, the way Trump views the presidency, I mean, it's a lot like The Godfather, man.
Yes.
Like, that's the way he thinks that the show works.
He does not by any means understand the powers of the presidency.
No.
You know, and that's the same reason that he's always talking about sending the military places, you know, and that's why I sent all these people down to the border, you know, like that's what I'm saying. Like, this is not your job. He doesn't have an understanding of what the military is supposed to do, of what he's supposed to do, of what the legislature does, what the judiciary does. He's out here, he's arguing with the Chief Justice, you know, over the role of the Supreme Court.
Chief Justice Roberts?
Yeah. He's out here arguing with him. They're putting out, you know, whatever op-eds and statements and shit back and forth about what the role of the Supreme Court is in the country.
Mm-hmm.
That's ridiculous.
It is.
Why are we having to explain basic civics to the leader of our country? Why?
Because we elected a reality TV host.
Like, I can't believe that. You know what I'm saying? Like, that. Like, you got to feel, I have to hope, and this is not me shitting on anybody personally, but I have to hope that if you voted for President Trump, you feel like a fucking idiot.
Yes.
Because you have to sit back and see, I helped elect somebody who doesn't understand his job. He doesn't understand how this country works.
Yeah. And I think, you know, that was a lot – well, for one, that was a lot of his appeal in the beginning. It was, well, he's an outsider. He's going to go in there. He's going to run it like a business.
Horrible.
Well, he's running it like a shady corporation, shady corporate business.
He's running it like his business.
Yeah.
Like his business with his dad and all this bullshit.
Oh.
Skirting taxes, all the fucking nonsense.
It's like – it's like a mirror image, man.
It's like you maybe could have seen this coming had you have seen his taxes before he got into office.
Oh, yeah.
Fucking,
man.
But weird.
They're all under audit, man. I mean, it's a stack. I mean, you wouldn't believe how many pages he says. Did you actually watch that full last press conference that he did?
No.
Like the one where he barred Jim Acosta afterwards and all that? Whoa, boy.
No, but I have
that.
I have that in my grab bag.
That was a roller coaster.
Yeah.
But, okay, well, if it's in the grab bag, we'll move on because that sounds awesome.
Yeah, because that's pretty much all that I have here for the actual statement itself.
I got so much more, but it's...
But I think that shit's really important, you know? And maybe you can, if there's a way for you to put out this actual part of it where you've highlighted the things that are true and aren't true and are half true. There's a way for you to put that out. That would, I think, be nice for people to be able to see.
I think I could do that on the blog. I'll have to check.
Yeah. And see if you haven't just screen cap it on your computer and then put that picture up, you know, like that would be fine. So, but I think it would be helpful to, for people to be able to see that. And, you know, you can kind of write in there what your key is, you know, that yellow things are true, orange is like half true, and this shit that's in red is totally a fucking lie.
Don, you are just full of wonderful ideas today.
My brain's pumping the last couple weeks. I got good things cracking.
You got that B12 rolling? So,
Penny, are you
falling? That must be it. I took some B12 this morning.
Really?
Yeah. Carolina bought this sublingual one. They just put in, and you just let it sit there for like 5 minutes. It's like super awesome cherry flavored.
Ooh.
It's really good. I have it every morning along with all my mushroom amalgamations. But like, no kidding, I will tell you, I feel so much sharper now that I take those kind of supplements in the morning.
Yeah.
Neurogenesis is real, bro. It's a real thing. You feel like, yeah. Anyways.
So you're ready to move on to Trumpy things?
Yeah, let's do it.
The second topic that we have here. So the first thing that I have, I think maybe the only thing I have for Trumpy things, is that I read an article the other day, either on Thursday or Friday, about the Justice Department, not the Justice Department. It is the House Judiciary Committee led by Mr. Goodlatte, right? Mr. Goodlatte.
Yeah, Goodlatte.
He
from Virginia.
Yeah.
Congressman.
He has subpoenaed James Comey and Loretta Lynch for them to come and speak to Congress about the Hillary Clinton email scandal and the way that it was handled between Loretta Lynch, James Comey, and Horowitz, David Horowitz.
And ties between the Trump campaign and Russia.
Yes. And James Comey is not happy about it, which I thought was interesting, which I actually kind of got down on, right? That James Comey just is not interested because he doesn't want it to be a closed session. He wants it to be open so everybody can hear what's going on, because he says that he has seen the way that things have been leaked and selectively leaked for them to be spun one way or another. He doesn't want that to happen. Which, say what you want about James Comey, I like that.
Yeah, he did it really well. It was on Thanksgiving. He tweeted out, "Happy Thanksgiving, period. Got a subpoena from House Republicans. I'm still happy to sit in the light and answer all questions, but I will resist a, quote, closed door, end quote, thing, because I've seen enough of their selective leaking and distortion. Let's have a hearing and invite everyone to see."
Which I totally agree with. For exactly as he said, there's been so much partisanship and claims from both sides that, oh, well, that's not exactly how that happened, and that's not what I said, and, you know, that's out of context, and that's whatever. Put it all out in the open. What does anybody have to hide? You know, don't ask him classified questions, because that you have to be done in a closed hearing. You know, but most of this stuff, people have the right to know.
So before we really get into that much further, let's break down Goodlatte. Did he run for re-election?
I don't know.
He did not.
Oh, right. He's retired. And I knew that he was. I wasn't sure if he had run and not won, or if he had retired.
He is retiring.
But yeah, I knew he wasn't going to be the head of it when the next session started.
And because this is a joint session that they're looking for. He called for a joint session between the House Judicial Committee and the what is it? It's the Intelligence Committee? No, it's the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee.
Oh, okay.
Who is headed by none other than Trey Gowdy,
South Carolina. And he is also retiring.
Exactly.
Right. Okay.
This is, when you look at it through purely a political lens, because I think that's all this is worth at this point.
Yes.
This is two guys who are on their way out who are trying to cause as much damage as absolutely possible for these two, because they feel that they have a vendetta to hit.
Yeah.
They don't feel justice was served. And we can argue about all day about whether or not there was some super shady shit that Loretta Lynch got involved with and possibly Comey and all this stuff. But I don't think that's what this is really about.
Which we did on the episode that we did with Casey and Drew.
Yes.
We actually talked about James Comey and Loretta Lynch.
Yep.
So you can go back. I'll try and link to that when I post the episode tomorrow. Yeah, because
I think Trey Gowdy's big stick up his butt is the tarmac meeting with Bill Clinton.
Yeah.
And of course, Good Lad's big thing is with Comey and the, you know, the way he kind of just absolutely railroaded and went, you know, he went out of line.
Definitely.
During the email investigation to come out and say that he was reopening that whole thing. And,
yeah.
You know, he referenced, which another thing I think we've talked about in the past, that Inspector General's report.
Yeah. David Horowitz is the Inspector General.
Yeah.
That's who I was talking about.
And so, yeah, that's this whole thing. You know, right now the subpoenas are supposed to be for James Comey, supposed to appear December 3rd, Loretta Lynch, December 4th. We haven't heard anything from Lynch yet, but James Comey, like I said, he made that announcement on Twitter, and CNN had reached out to one of his lawyers, and they said they will be fighting the subpoena for a closed door session in court.
James Comey's lawyers?
Yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. What did I say? Yeah.
You just said his lawyers.
James Comey's lawyers said they will be fighting the subpoena for a closed door session in court, though they're open to a public session.
I think that's a good idea. I think that's the way to do it.
And given the timeline, you fight this subpoena in court and the date passes. They no longer have a job anymore. And the whole thing is dead.
The Democrats probably won't do that.
Yeah.
And another reason why they're doing this is, like you said, they are Good Lad and Trey Gowdy are not going to be the heads of this anymore. They're not going to be congressmen anymore.
Yeah.
So another thing that the Republicans as a whole are concerned about is the storm of investigations that is likely to come from a Democrat-led House, right?
It's going
to
be subpoena central,
exactly.
Bro.
Exactly. And so that's why they're doing this now, is to kind of get their, like you said, get their last digs in before they leave, to be like, we also can cause noise. You know, there's also some shady shit that you did that we want to highlight before, you know, because that's all this is they're thinking about it, like you said, about party politics, you know?
Yeah.
So they're trying to take digs at anybody who can even be tied to the left or tied to the Democrats, you know, in any type of way.
Yeah.
And that's all they're doing.
And
not
like
all,
I
because
said,
I think this is legitimate, but because I think this is a really good thing to be looked into, but
it is.
It also, you know.
But it's so blatantly a political maneuver.
Yes. They found a legitimate hook to use. You know, they found a sturdy hook to use.
And I guess from the sounds of, you know, all the research I did into this, it sounds like they've been trying to do something like this for a while, and I don't know how they finally got this to happen at the end, but you know, who knows? There's going to be such a changeover in the House that, you know, they might have had enough people that are like, ah, screw it, yeah, I'm on board, let's do this,
yeah,
let's try it, you know. And like I said, it's a shame, because like I said, there, I would like to know about all these things, but it's gotten so partisan. This is all just political bickering at this point, and
absolutely,
it solves nothing. How much closer are we to having an actual answer for the DACA problem? Trying to fix the failing healthcare system? They're not doing anything other than, you know, playing politics with each other. They're all running investigations on each other, and this is, you know, and I think, I don't remember if I had brought it up last week or a couple of weeks ago. Somebody at my job the other day was talking, because he's kind of a newer hire, and I turned him on to the podcast, and he likes talking about stuff like this every now and again. And he said, you know, somebody, and I think it might have come off maybe an NPR podcast or something, but the question was raised during the healthcare, or no, it was before the healthcare debates, during like the Tea Party movement, this, that, and the other thing. I remember what it was now. It was the election special from the Daily Wire that I was listening to.
Okay.
But they talked about earmarks. And stop me if we've talked about this before.
Yep.
But when the Congress decided to do away with earmarks, I think it was after the Affordable Care Act went through, maybe. Could be wrong about that. But regardless, once we kind of decided that earmarks weren't a good thing, we didn't like them anymore, because it was just like, let's focus on one bill at a time, let's do all this, no more earmarks, effectively stopped Congress from being able to do anything. Because if you can't get your proposal on the floor, you know, think of how many things Derek Kilmer's tried to get put on the floor that just never make it.
Yeah.
Because it's not a big enough issue. Those things used to be done in earmarks, and they might have been able to get approved. But now that there's no such thing as earmarks in these big omnibus bills like that, Congress literally hasn't done a thing since the tax cut bill.
Yes.
You know, that's about it. I mean, they might have done little things here and there. You know, the sanctions and stuff like that. That's all requires congressional action. But realistically, as far as everyday legislation, ain't shit going to get it done for another at least 2 years. Because now it's just going to be infighting again. It's not going to be at a standstill.
Well, and you have to have like a hefty enough majority, you know, to do it. Because even with the majorities that the Republicans had in the House and the Senate, they still couldn't get dick done.
No.
You know, because they fucked themselves over and had to have 60 and all that shit. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know. It's, I don't understand. I mean, I understand it, but it pisses me off because the one job that you get paid to do, you're not doing, and all you're doing is getting involved in the drama.
Yeah.
It feels like high school. It does. Like, all this crap just feels like high-stakes high school drama.
Yeah.
With us as the, you know, the innocent bystanders involved in it. But yeah, that's... Any more Trumpy news? Oh, the Mueller team has...
I was going to say, I thought you had something.
Yeah, I did have the... Because I've been trying to just watch this Mueller investigation because I keep hearing stories about... There's a lot of signs that it's starting to wrap up. And I think this may or may not be. You never really know because the investigation isn't about Trump as much as he likes to think it's about Trump.
Yeah.
But he did... You know, his legal team and him did submit some written answers to the Mueller team's questions on Tuesday this last week.
Yes.
And again, he only answered questions that were, related to the, you know, as he would call the witch hunt, you know, stuff about him and his campaign and all this stuff. And so, you know, and then apparently he dodged questions about Comey and this and that and the other thing. So he did submit some written answers.
But he didn't answer all the questions.
From my understanding, it didn't sound like he answered all of them, which I don't think he had to.
Offered to answer questions.
Yeah, because that's been a whole other debate is whether or not he can be subpoenaed to answer. But so there's movement on that front. I don't know what it'll come to. There was another one of Roger Stone's. Is it Roger Stone's? Roger Stone.
I think so.
A Trump official, you know, a associate, I guess, or something like that. Going back, he's been tied to, you know, the actual Russia investigation, and he's in the middle of a plea deal bargain with the Mueller team, not Roger Stone. One of his associates is in a plea deal with the Mueller investigation too. So I mean, they're slowly but surely collecting. You know, tying up loose ends on this thing, and more people keep getting subpoenaed, and you know, there's a lot of plea deals going on.
Well, I saw today that I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, I was about to say George Papadopoulos.
That's what I was going to say. I just saw this morning. Yeah, that George Papadopoulos has to go to jail now.
Yeah,
I think he was on house arrest for a while, but now he has to show up to jail. I didn't read that article. I just saw that had happened.
Well, he it was funny. He came out and said James Comey was to drop the legal action to fight the subpoena, he would stop pursuing immunity. I was like, dude, I'm pretty sure it's too late for that. I'm pretty sure you're going to jail.
Yeah.
You're not a big enough player in this, bro.
No. Not anywhere near enough.
Yeah. I saw that yesterday. And I was just like, bro, come on, man.
What an idiot.
What are you saying? He is an idiot. That's why he got caught up in this, because he's an idiot.
Yeah.
Trumpy news. I think that's about it for my Trumpy news.
Well, we can hit some grab bag topics. Uh-huh. I got some of those built up.
I have a non-political one, too.
Let's see here. grab bag. Okay, so there. One of my grab bags was the James Comey thing. Okay, so... I have a couple things about Ben Shapiro, right? I've had a real stick up my ass for Ben Shapiro the last couple weeks.
I've listened to like an episode and a half in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah. So when the shooting at the synagogue happened, right? Like
yes.
2 weeks ago or something like that. One of the episodes of Ben Shapiro, like right after that happened, he compared President Trump's statement to Barack Obama's statement. And he's like, do you see how this one is so much better and blah, 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 blah. Okay, Barack Obama's not the fucking president anymore.
No.
Why does it matter? Why does what he has to say about this shooting even a little bit compare to what President Trump is saying right now? Because Barack Obama is just a person now. He's just a citizen. He's an ex-president. President Trump is the sitting president in the office right now.
That's because...
Why is Barack Obama's statement anywhere near important like compared to that?
Because when you listen to the Ben Shapiro, Don, the Ben Shapiro show, he... It's a show. It is a show. He plays the own the libs game on his show. And if, mind you, when there's really, really important stuff to talk about, if there's a ton of things going on, he usually just hits the facts and moves on.
Yeah.
You know, maybe sprinkle a little Shapiro, you know, nihilism or I don't know what you want to call it on top of it. But when there's not a whole lot going on, it is all own the libs all the time.
It's horrible.
And it is. And it's very distinct. It's a distinctive difference when you listen to his show and listen to him on someone else's show.
Yeah.
Or
yes.
Listen to him on his Sunday specials.
I much prefer him on someone else's show. When he's on Joe Rogan, that long form Joe Rogan, Ben Shapiro's awesome.
Yep.
I love Ben Shapiro on Joe Rogan.
But when he's doing his show, he is a different Ben Shapiro. He does a show and he knows it. And he said it as much. That's why I liked when I watched the election special from the Daily Wire. I don't like either one of their personalities, any of their personalities for the most part that much. I like Ben more than I like anybody. But then there's like Andrew Klavan, Michael Knowles, and then they always have their – who they call their God King, Jeremy Boring.
Yeah.
Who's a very interesting, well-spoken individual. But when the four of them get together and they're smoked cigars, drinking scotch, except for Ben because he doesn't do any of them.
I was going to say what?
Yeah, they all sit around. They drink cigars. Michael Knowles in his infinite pretentiousness.
Drink the cigars.
He sits there in a Hugh Hefner smoking jacket.
Of course.
Smoke cigars and they all drink whiskey, except for Ben who sits there in the corner choking on the smoke and drinking water. But that was like, man, that thing went for like 5 hours. And they have some very, very good conversations. Very, like you said, Joe Rogan style long form.
Yeah.
Except it's all politics all the time. But when you put him on his show, he plays the character that's on his show.
It's horrible.
And that's why half the time, especially knowing what he is off the show, it's hard for me to digest all that crap.
I know who you are, Ben Shapiro.
I know who you are. I listen to everything you say. I know what's different and what's not.
But
I forgot the point I was trying to make there. But in his defense, that's just his character on his show, I think, that he plays. And I don't like it because, like I said, I haven't listened to more than an episode and a half, I think, in 2 weeks. Because as of right now, it's just own the libs, own the libs. I didn't listen to right after that synagogue shooting happened. I didn't listen to the show for a week because I knew that's all he would talk about. And I didn't want to hear his... You know, because as an Orthodox Jew, he's going to be very, very heated about this, and it's going to become anti-Semitism, anti-Semitism, anti-Semitism.
Right.
Which, as we know from a New York Times article that never got covered, anti-Semitism and anti-Semitic hate crimes in New York City have skyrocketed over this last year, and nobody's talking about it. And it's a problem. But the Jews are kind of one of those... You know, unprotected class in the, you know, in that oppression Olympics hierarchy. And nobody really knows what to do with them because they're like kind of white and they're relatively successful. But they also have like a very long history of like systematic oppression.
Yeah.
Like nobody really knows what to do with them. So just nobody talks about it. And, you know, once that.
Except for the Jews.
Except for the Jews. They talk about them all the time. And that's why I love the Commentary Magazine podcast. Which, side note, how happy are you that Sora Mari is no longer a part of that?
Yeah, that's pretty great.
He got hard. Man, I used to get so tired of him.
You want more beer?
Yeah, I could definitely use another beer.
Got some in my fridge.
I'm so happy I have a designated driver today. But do you know where he ended up going to, Don?
No.
He is now going to be the editor at the New York Post. Yeah, which is hilarious because if you follow the commentary guys like I do, because they're If you're into like old man Jewish humor, they're perfect. Especially New York old man Jewish humor. It's just the driest, most delicious like dad joke stuff ever. But beautiful.
Which one do you want?
Boom. I'll take the Red Hook, son. Thank you.
Yep.
But yeah, John Podhoretz, the founder of Commentary Magazine, or his dad or whatever. Yeah, Mr. Mouthbreather.
Yeah.
He actually writes columns for the New York Post. And so they were joking around one day. And now Sohrab is going from having John as his editor at Commentary to now being John's editor over at the New York Post.
That's funny.
I thought that was hilarious.
I've never read anything by Sohrab. Actually, I think I did, and I wasn't a fan just because of the way that it, the article itself, but not like the way that it was written. But
I've been listening to it long enough. I got guilt-tripped into looking at the actual magazine online and reading it.
Really?
And I hate to say it, but I'm about to pay for an actual subscription to that because I really enjoy Commentary Magazine. Colin. I really do.
You're too
I
much.
Mean, I am a... I don't know what I am these days.
I'm just an old New York Jew. It's no
but I enjoy a good conservative magazine.
Yeah, no shit.
I don't know why. that's... Maybe that's something we could talk about for a minute. The... somebody on the Twitters the other day, we were talking... it was in a Joe Rogan thread, I think, or a...
Total Domination.
It's a good one. From Ninkasi.
The Ninkasi.
Out of Eugene, Oregon.
It's a really pretty color.
Ooh. So hazy.
Yeah.
Actually, it's not
zoom
that hazy.
Zoom in on that, motherfuckers.
I could do that, I think. I think I have the technical know-how to do that now. But what was I saying? Oh, yeah. These people, they got in an argument on Twitter. They were talking about... Joe Rogan went off on a rant about... I think it was when he was talking to Eric Weinstein.
That's nice.
About... Oh, yeah. Eric Weinstein had an amazing tweet. I think added you on it.
About the weed.
Yeah. And I thought it was important. But anyways, it was involving a kind of a rant that he went off with, I think it was Eric, when he was on the show last week about how, you know, they know a guy or we know a guy who kind of essentially just is they think he's confused when it comes to – he's still kind of involved in the picking of your own softball team.
Mm-hmm.
You're going from one team to now you're on the other team. And these guys were trying to say that, like, it was code for Dave Rubin because Dave Rubin has become such an outspoken, you know, he calls himself a classical liberal, but realistically, he screws around a lot with the libertarian ideals. And so he's like trying to find a team to kind of belong to. And I don't really necessarily.
I think classical liberal and libertarian have a lot of overlay.
Oh, definitely.
I think are, you know.
In the Venn diagram of political ideologies, there's definitely a lot of overlaps there.
It's like classical liberalism is libertarianism that makes more sense. You know, like there's a bunch of shit and libertarianism you come to and you're like, I don't know, just because. You know, like there's a little more
freedom.
Like reason behind. Yeah, just like because I'm a person and fucking nobody can tell me what to do. You know?
It's the Wild West version of America.
Yes.
This is what Red Dead Redemption 2 has instilled in me. No kidding. It honestly, like in the pre-show, I said, you know, there's a lot of values and stuff that are hidden in that game. And you ever seen the movie? It's a Kevin Costner, Robert Duvall. It's called Open Range.
It's called Open Range?
Yeah. Mm. Great cowboy movie. But essentially, it focuses kind of like in Red Dead, how like there's this last group of like people that moved out west.
The outlaws.
Where everything was just basically free.
Yeah.
You just kind of made it work because civilization hadn't necessarily caught up yet. And then like in Red Dead, you're at that moment where like the trains are here. There's power lines going up. Yeah. There's telegraph wires. I mean, there's civilization is here. And the days of true libertarian style freedom where nobody could really tell you what to do unless you belong to a mini town or a city or something where you decided they all came up with the rules.
Yeah.
But libertarianism at its true heart is it's the Wild West. It's like, you can't tell me what to do. And as long as I'm not hurting you, you better fuck off because I'm a libertarian. Right. I don't need a seatbelt if I drive. I don't need a driver's license. I can drive my car just fine. I know plenty of people with driver licenses who are terrible drivers who shouldn't be on the road.
I don't need to register with the government for anybody to know that I exist.
Yeah. It's a real... I also been watching a lot of King of the Hill lately. It's real Dale Dribble stuff, man. I don't trust computers.
So I have another one about Ben Shapiro that happened last week after Amazon announced the two cities that it was going to put its headquarters in.
Yeah. Did we mention that?
I don't know. But
Crystal City in Virginia. Northern Virginia. Yeah. And which I guess is pretty close to the home of Jeff Bezos.
And then one in New York City.
Right? Yeah. In Long Island City, which I'm intimately familiar with.
And so when that happened, Ben Shapiro went over that, right? And it got me super heated to listen to that because he gave a really disingenuous synopsis of several things, but one of them of the head tax, right? Gave just a terrible overview of what it was.
Yeah.
And then went in about why Amazon doesn't want to be in Seattle anymore and why they're leaving and all this shit, which is not explained to be true. I mean, that's really not how it looks. And then just, you know, barely explained the housing crisis, didn't talk about, you know, didn't go over any of the negative things that people point to about Amazon in this area, you know, and only pointed all the glowing things. And it's like, well, and it's just that way in the Northwest because they're fucking liberals and they don't know what the fuck they're talking about.
Exactly. You know?
That's not exactly the case.
Yeah. First of all, to try to even explain that in his show is just about an hour.
Yeah.
If you were to take that entire hour and try to explain that system, you might be able to do that if you spoke at Ben Shapiro's speed and, you know, had his, you know, the way he hits facts really, really quick and all that.
Yeah.
But he did not do that. It was totally disingenuous. It was utter garbage and nonsense.
About that.
I was so pissed because this is obviously a thing that we have looked into extensively.
We had like that whole show about it. We had like an hour and a half conversation about the fucking head tax. You know what I'm saying?
I feel like we talked about it twice.
Because we talked about it briefly, and then the next week we had a whole deal about it.
That's right.
That was what we talked about that week.
I think that's when we first started getting into like the main segments idea.
Because we had done three before that, but this is when we're like two is the key. Mm-hmm. Two in the grab bag is the key.
Yeah.
So So I wasn't a fan of that. And then I was listening to the Meat Eater podcast, right?
Yes.
And they were talking about a guy that they knew or had heard about that was a vegan, right?
Okay.
But he was also a hunter.
Interesting.
But he just donated all the meat.
Oh.
Like he would hunt something and then would just donate all the meat, right?
Still can't be vegan. That's fine.
And so...
I agree with what you're doing, but you're...
Oh, vegetarian. Sorry. I have vegetarian written down. So he's not a vegan. Sorry. So he's a vegetarian that hunts and then donates the meat, right? And so they had this conversation about it because Steven Ranella was like, said, I just have some type of like fundamental type of problem with that I don't really know what it is, you know? He's like, but that you're out there to be hunting animals and to not be claiming the meat, you know? He's like, because that's like part of my whole deal.
Mm-hmm.
And they had someone on there who is like a guide. And he said, there's been people I've had out before that he said, I'm not saying that's the case with this vegetarian guy, right? He said, but I've had people out with me before that I've guided with, and I got the sense from them that they enjoyed more the killing aspect than like the protein meat, like hunting aspect of it. And he said, and I haven't asked them back because I don't like that outlook on it.
Yeah.
You know, and I just thought that was really interesting.
Like, it is, because I think if you're going to have, I mean, if you want to be a hunter for whatever reason and enjoy the sport of the tracking and the skill that it takes to do a hunt and you give the animal reverence enough, I can see how, like, I wouldn't have a problem with that as long as the meat isn't being wasted. And, you know, that's fine. But I can understand somebody like Steven Ranella, who is more personal, you know, having kind of a mental block about it. Both sides I think are justified.
Yeah.
You know, as long as you're not going, I mean, like I said, as long as the hunt is done with due reverence to the kill, then I think there's no harm, no foul.
He also said, and he was like, maybe this makes me kind of a bad guy, you know? He's like, but I just don't trust it. You know, he's like, there's something off about someone just wanting to donate 200 pounds of meat. You know, he's like, that's just, he's like, there's just something off about it. Like that you're taking your own personal money to go out there and hunt it, you know, and assuming you're doing the processing yourself, you know, and you're buying all the ammo or the arrows and shit, like you're taking all of this cost out of yourself and then you're just donating.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he's like, that just seems off to me for some reason, you know?
Yeah, it's like having a hobby with no real payoff.
Yeah.
Other than the adrenaline of killing that animal, maybe.
And that's why the guy was talking about, he's like, there's the people I haven't asked back, you know, because mm-hmm. I don't want someone who's out there just because they want to kill stuff.
Yeah.
I was like, that's not right. But I thought it was real interesting.
I'm going on I don't know how long technically it's going to be. That I'll actually be out there, but I think it's going to be a 9-day hunt next year, the end of October, going up to the, you know, like north, you know, definitely northern Washington. It's kind of northeastern Washington, but we're getting tags for elk, deer, bear, and cougar, just in case we find a cougar, of course. But yeah, but it's going to be a full on week long, you know, a little bit more. Pack in, you know, pack all the food in, all the water, all that good stuff. Going to go out and get as much meat as we possibly can.
Yeah.
Next year.
You going to let me give it some of that?
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a really big chest freezer at the house, as you know, but most of it's full of like cow and stuff from our slaughtered cows.
Delicious steak.
I'm going to have to power through some of that stuff and make room for a... hopefully an elk.
Well, we'll help you anytime. Jordan loves steak.
Absolutely.
Yeah. We love a good steak.
Yeah. We actually cooked some game meat on Thanksgiving. Did I tell you about that?
You guys have a goose?
Yeah, we had a goose. We had a goose, a turkey for, you know, a store-bought turkey.
Standard style.
Yeah, we did have a goose that my brother shot 2 weeks ago.
Nice.
I think it was 2 weeks ago.
Shout out, Chad.
And then we also had some venison that he had also got.
Shout out Chad.
Yeah. And that was, man.
He's out here blasting.
Yeah. And that's the thing, man. His girlfriend, a wonderful human being who she is, but she lived her whole life. She never ate, you know, she doesn't eat beef. She doesn't eat pork. What's happening on the football
game? It was absurd. Chris Carson, he tried to jump over somebody. Tried to jump over somebody, mm-hmm. and he got tackled and literally did a flip in the middle of the air and then landed on his feet in one hand and got up and kept running.
Yes!
Look at it. Look at it. Look. So the flip.
Oh.
So all the way flip.
One hand. Knees.
Lands it.
Oh, is the knee down?
I think that it was, but he's like, what's good?
Yeah.
And gets up and still tries to keep going.
Always play it safe. Keep running.
What the fuck?
Always keep running.
Absurd, dog.
Until that ref blows a whistle and ends the play, you keep running.
Chris Carson's good.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, Chris Carson's good.
That's some straight up Dougie Fresh jumping over people on the for field goals type of stuff.
I like that.
I love it when that happens. Oh, but yeah, really excited. Hopefully this time next year, I will be flush with game meat.
Flush with game meat.
Yeah. And I guess I got to talk to some more game wardens about it. Because he had talked to a guy the other day. I guess it's kind of a gray area. I guess in certain parts of Washington, you're not supposed to bait bears.
Yeah. Well, but that's kind of a moral thing.
Like, yeah, right. Unless you're really in on it. I can see it like if that's your only food supply and you have a reliable source of food, I'm down with baiting bears.
Yeah.
But from my understanding, there's kind of a gray area out there right now where if you hunt a deer or an elk or something else and you leave the gut pile there, that can be used, classified as a bait. And you are allowed then, I think, that's why I said I got to hammer this stuff out because, you know, I might be interested in that. Because have you ever had bear meat before?
No.
It's fantastic.
Is it?
Yeah.
I'm down.
I had bear when I was in Russia.
Babe, would you
eat on
bear?
My 18th birthday.
Why not?
Why not? It tastes from the experience that I had with bear. Mind you, it was at a restaurant in Russia.
Yeah.
But it tasted like pot roast. It was dark meat, kind of perfectly tender and stringy. It was fell off the bone. It was fantastic. So hopefully, like I said, hopefully next year I'll be flush with game meat. What else you got in there?
So let's see. I also have Mehdi Hasan, right? Mehdi Hasan, who does the Deconstructed podcast that is the offshoot.
Yeah. That waste of...
So
mouth breather.
So I like Mehdi Hasan to the effect that when he interviews somebody, he don't take no shit. Mm-mm. You know, he's going to be up your ass about anything you said that is not correct and making you explain it. And I really like that about Mehdi Hasan. And I've seen him.
Yeah, you not have to, correct or not well, so correct you, with his narrative.
So you have to, you got to look up videos, right? Because on his show, he only has people that are against him that he's attacking, you know? Yeah. But in the videos, like on YouTube and stuff, he's been around for so long that he's talked to people on all manners of the spectrum, and that's how you can kind of get a better idea of who he is.
You know? He basically always kind of worked for Intercept?
No. He used to work for like Al Jazeera, I think, and like some other shit. So he's worked for several different places, but has always been the same type of way. And that's where it's easier to be more comfortable with him. Because, yeah it's... A lot of the shit
his show hasn't changed. Is
crazy. No. Yeah. So, but if you get him with the right person, you know, his shit makes sense. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, there's some people, like you said, the narratives that he pumps just doesn't really.
Doesn't
make a lot of sense.
I think the last episode I listened to with him, he was.
That's bullshit. That's a fucking teeter.
I mean, he was blatantly just shitting all over the way we have a judicial system in America with the Supreme Court and federal judges.
That's a fucking teeter, dog. What the fuck?
Are they not calling
That's a fucking is that teeter.
Tyler Lockett?
Look at this shit. Look at that. And over the plane, that's a fucking teeter.
He's in, baby.
That's a touchdown.
Review the play.
That's bullshit.
We need to get ahead here. It's 10-13.
That's bullshit.
Come on.
Sorry.
We're like 5 minutes into the third quarter here.
He's good, dude. He's good.
Yeah, because his knees are down in the end zone.
But that's fine. He hasn't been tackled. He's down to catch the ball. He's fucking good. He's totally fine. That's gold. That's bullshit. That's right, challenge. That's fucking right, challenge. That's gold.
So they called it not a touchdown?
Yes. Fuck that line, judge. Yep.
All right, we're going to have to wait.
Lock it.
TV commercial break for the challenge.
Old T-Lock.
I love when we can do like mini commentaries and games while we do the show. Just because it allows me to actually watch the game a little bit.
Yeah.
I have such a hard time watching football now.
Okay.
I just can't fit it in. Anyways, so this guy.
Hasan, a couple weeks ago, he was talking to somebody who used to be a white supremacist, right?
Okay.
And he has a group, and I can't remember what the group is called, but I'll go back. I'll listen to it. Fact check. I'll go and find it. And I'll listen to that group again, and I'll tweet it out. And so he belonged to a group that was fighting to counter white supremacy, right? Okay. And he was part of a group of 30 other groups that are all different charities doing different social shit. And that's, I'll have to re-listen to it to get a better idea because I wrote it down really generally, right?
But this guy was a white supremacist or he used to be
white supremacist and now he fights against white supremacy, right? Okay. And he leads a charity that fights against white supremacy.
Okay.
And so that charity is part of some group that's recognized by the government. That's of like 30 or so other charities that all do social shit, right?
Okay.
So that got reviewed when President Trump came into office. And his group, his charity is the only one in that group of 30 whatevers that got its funding cut.
Oh.
The one that actively fights against white supremacy.
Interesting.
And so that's one of the things that people use to say that Trump is a racist and a white supremacist is these people whose job it is, who's made it their job to fight against white supremacy. They had their funding cut under the Trump administration. It's more legitimate than that. That's why I said it's very general. I'll send it to you because it's more legitimate than just what I'm saying here. There's way more that goes into the back of it.
I can surely see that happening.
Well, and I'm not saying that says that he's a racist, but it certainly doesn't look very good that this is the only group in this.
Yeah, because I would imagine it's probably some – just because – just kind of going off of what we know of T-Dog Millionaire.
Yeah.
And – I know we used to have this thing about talking about President Trump, but I have a hard time saying that all the time.
Yeah.
But anyway, when you look at Trump, the way he talks, the way he wants to run things, I could see him just wanting to cut all spending to any kind of charity groups. And so I would imagine him finding some random loophole to find one guy that was like, well, hey, we're cutting your funding. I wonder what
it's the a touchdown. Exactly. Boom. It's a fucking touchdown. T-Lock in the end zone. It's a fucking touchdown.
That puts the Hawks ahead of the Panthers.
Yep. Yep. It's about to be 17-13. I'm in a real struggling spot in fantasy this week.
Don't talk to me about struggling spots, dude.
Yeah.
My Yeah, my secondary quarterback just broke both his leg bones, compound fracture on the field the other day.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, man, that was – I don't know why. I knew when I pulled up that video because I didn't watch the game.
It was bad.
So I saw the IR report hit on my fantasy thing, and I saw a big fat zero there. And so I went and I YouTubed it, and I cringed so hard. I watched it one time, and I saw this – rubber leg flopping around on the field, and I said, nope. But what a trooper, though. Got the air cast on like that, and he was totally composed going off the field on the cart. Props to Alex Smith. Hopefully he still has a job pretty soon.
I think that it's all that I have for the grab bag.
So I had mentioned it earlier, but let's talk about Black Friday for a second.
Yes.
Do you participate in the glorious phenomenon that is Black Friday?
Fuck no, I hate people.
Me too.
Oh, Jim Acosta, I got that too. We could talk about
it. Oh, yeah. Yeah, because I haven't really been following that.
Yeah. No, I fucking hate people. I definitely don't go out on Black Friday. I went
it's to a nightmare.
The Mexican place and watched the Civil War. But that's it. The Ducks won. The Civil War is when Oregon plays Oregon State. And the first time they did it was in like 1898 or some such shit. And the Ducks won this year 55-15. It was a smashing and it was beautiful.
It was a smashing. Yeah. on that note, I was listening to NPR on the way over here because I am officially an old man who likes to listen to NPR all the time.
Me too.
Pound. But they were talking about the – I didn't know this happened. Was that Apple Cup? The Huskies Wazoo game.
Okay.
It always goes down. The bus that was carrying the UW band crashed.
Yes.
And all the people had to go to the hospital. It sounded like everyone's okay, which is good. But the Wazoo band decided to last minute go in. They pulled up the sheet music for the UW fight song.
Yeah.
And they actually played the UW fight song in reverence.
Yeah.
And it was really cool. I thought that was,
very nice.
The rivalry between those two schools is very, very real.
It's deep.
I feel it in my office all the time because most of, I work with a lot of civil engineers.
Yeah.
And of course, to be a civil engineer, you got to go to college. So the majority of them either went to UW or WSU. And so there's this huge rivalry even at my job.
I'm happy I'm not involved in that.
Me too. You know, my mom, I think, went to Wazoo. My grandfather went to UW, and they have a rivalry between the two of them. But that was a really cool thing I heard on NPR on the way over here this morning. I thought that was pretty cool.
Well, and if we lived in Oregon, I'd be in bad shape, you know? an Oregon State band is rare around here. It just doesn't really happen that much.
You guys are kind of an eclectic small group.
Yeah. Well, Oregon itself has a fair amount of fans up here, but Oregon State, the Beavers, don't have as many fans up here.
Yeah.
So it's an easier existence. Mm-hmm. But like Corvallis, which is where Oregon State is, and Eugene, which is where Oregon is, are only like 44 miles from each other.
See, that's a tough one. They're
really pretty close. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you're, doing anything in between the two, you're going to see a bunch of people who, who are wearing Oregon State shit.
Well, do you know much about Oregon State?
What are you like
the state of Oregon?
I mean,
there's a whole lot of desert there. We'll say that.
Yeah.
And so I would imagine, like any big hubs of, civilization got to be pretty close to kind of like that northwest corner.
Yeah.
And that makes sense that they'd be that close now that I think about the geography of it all.
You drive past Corvallis on your way to Eugene.
There's not that. And that Eugene's not that far from Portland.
No.
And Portland's right there when you go across the bridge.
Yeah.
You know, that's a pretty, I like that rivalry. We had one back when I went to high school because there used to only be one North Kitsap High School. It was back before Kingston High School was even a thing. And our big rivalry was Bainbridge. Because we were
Bainbridge High School?
Yeah, because you're like 15, 20 minutes away. And we had a ton of rivalry between the two of us. And I think to this day, that's probably one of the reasons why I have such a love-hate relationship with Bainbridge Island. You know, they got class.
Just a bunch of douches out there on
Bainbridge. Yeah. They got a bunch of class and a bunch of money.
Bunch of class.
So let's talk about Black Friday.
Yes.
You and I don't participate necessarily in the madness of Black Friday.
No.
I get deals online if I can, but I'm not leaving the house to go to Walmart.
Yeah, I'll buy some stuff online if I got money.
But I saw actually it was brought to me by a very close member of my family, tried to tell me that Black Friday was dated back to the slave trade. And so I decided that.
Really?
Yeah. And so I was like, okay. Sure, man. I'll just nod because I don't want to have this conversation with you.
Yeah, I never heard that before.
And so I looked it up, and it is kind of vague. No one 100% knows where it came from. But the most kind of logical explanation dates back to, I think, the early 50s and 60s in Philadelphia, when the Philadelphia PD had to start taking extra shifts in days where they usually would have had days off. Because of the massive influx in suburban consumers that would flood the streets, and they'd have to deal with much more shoplifting and just, you know, disorderly conduct and all the craziness that came with it, they started to coin the day as Black Friday.
Well, and I guess I thought that it came from, like, companies are trying to get into the black. You know, like you're using this to get from the red to the black. And I guess I thought that's what this was.
Yeah. And that is another common one. But that really didn't come into existence, I think, until the late 80s, early 90s.
Interesting.
And so that's like right now, it's kind of I think it's much like many of our fake ass holidays that we have.
Yeah.
We just kind of determined that, okay, no, this is a thing that we do now. It's a weird phenomenon that just kind of happens. And I don't think it was ever really orchestrated. And for whatever reason, that term got coined and is now kind of just the day.
However that happened.
Yeah. And even though that, you know, there is no factual context that date back to the days of the slave trade or anything, states like California have decided to push, you know, to call it things like just the day after Thanksgiving sale. And because they don't, you know, it's California. So
they don't want to be racist.
Yeah.
You know, because that's racist.
Because you can't say the word black anymore without being racist apparently.
Racist AF.
Yeah. And I've seen that rolling around on the internet now, in the Twitterverse, in the Facebook world, these random people that post this thing about Black Friday. And, you know, you have your SJWs and stuff that are trying to stand on this thing. And all you got to do is go to Snopes and it'll shoot you right down.
It'll tell you.
And then you can do your own, you can find your own rabbit hole to crawl into and find as much information as you want about that. But Black Friday is not racist. Just leave it alone.
It's
just a stupid Hallmark type holiday that, you know, is driven by money from, you know, people that make a lot of money.
Last week, Dave used the term the blacks. I don't know if you caught that.
It
caught me aback just for a second because I don't know the last time that I heard someone use the term the blacks, right? And so then I was like, that's not racist though. That's just like certainly not with intent, you know, like it would, I can see how someone would be like, that's racist, but I don't think personally that it is. But I thought it was just really interesting. Like how I dealt with it personally, you know, I was like, that's really strange.
If that's not a generational gap, I don't know what is.
Yeah, because I don't think that if I was to describe the African-American community, I would ever use the term the blacks, you know. And I also don't say African-American every time because you're also black. Like, that's like whatever. But I also think that, and this is a totally a personal thing, but I've been listening to a lot of Kendrick Lamar. Lately, right? Lots of Kendrick Lamar. He's got one of these songs. Yeah, I think.
Yeah.
When he says
original. That, stole it from Nelly.
When he says that he's an Israelite.
Oh, is Usher? Yep. Thank you, Jordan. Thank you.
It
shows me how involved I was in that situation.
He says, I'm an Israelite. Don't call me black no more. That shit is only a color. And I thought that that was really interesting. And then I think, you know, that same week that I like recognized that line is also the week that Dave is like the blacks. And
yeah.
I just thought,
Yeah, it's a weird kind of holdover back from And I mean, it still happens in today's, like, you know, in the PC age where you have to give everybody some kind of ethnic denomination, like you're Asian American, you're African American, you're Pan Asian American.
And that's what I thought was maybe that's just too PC for me to be like, is the blacks okay? It obviously didn't make me uncomfortable after, like, well, maybe I got to bleep this out what's in here because Dave said the blacks, you know?
Yeah.
Well, and I've also sat here and said it 30 times while we're talking about it. So it doesn't make me too uncomfortable. But the first time I heard it.
It's because in true context, it he's just referencing a group of people.
Yeah.
And not in a derogatory fashion. He was just speaking in a way generally.
I do it myself.
Yeah. And I think, at least for me, I see futility in judging groups because regardless of what they are.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you're talking about, you know, the quote unquote group of African Americans in America. Okay. First of all, there's no way you can actually group any of those people, all together to have one thing in common. And that's their ethnic background. What does that have to do with anything? Who gives a shit? Drives me insane. The only thing I care about is what you got going on up here in the old noggin and what the hell is coming out of your fucking mouth.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all I care about. I will judge you accordingly and how you act and move in society. It doesn't matter. I mean, for God's sake, I married a Spanish woman. That was, that was my bad. I took that burden on. I'm just kidding. I love you, sweetheart. It just doesn't make any logical sense to me to think about that kind of crap when it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, so I'm a white guy. Done. That's a pretty broad group. Better narrow it down. Okay, I'm a tall white guy. No, that doesn't work either. So let's narrow down my ethnic background. Well, the problem is I'm a white guy. I could have a billion different backgrounds because there's a lot of white people in the world.
Yeah.
You know, and they're all spread out all over the world. And guess what? The same is true with black people. There are black people all over the world there's black people in South America, in Mexico, in, all over Africa, all over Europe. The same thing with, we'll just generalize, say, people from the Southern Asian part of the continent. So there's the Middle East and there's kind of, I don't know if you call that the Near East, the Far East, kind of like India, Pakistan, Mongolia, that kind of area. I mean, they're all over it's a big fucking world and it's 2018, bro. All of us are all over the place. And I think it's futile and it serves no purpose to categorize people by ethnicity for whatever you're talking about. It just doesn't make any sense because it doesn't tell me anything about who you are as a human fucking being.
Yeah.
But I'll step off my high horse. Don't look at that Dallas Redskins game, bro.
It's important for sports.
Very well. Well, I have a really quick non-political piece of grab bag news.
Let's hear it.
Scientific news, if you will.
Scientific
news. Monday, big Monday, the day this podcast drops. So if you're listening at Tuesday, late in the game, it happened. No, we have a new Mars lander landing down on Mars.
Oh.
It is the InSight lander, which I just thought was a cool name.
When did it get InSight launched?
When did it get launched? 6 months ago.
Word.
So it is InSight. Yeah, the newest NASA Mars lander is set for touchdown on the surface of Mars Monday. The InSight lander will be the first NASA probe to land on Mars in 6 years. It's scheduled to end its six-month, 300-million-mile journey at approximately 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Monday. Now, this was kind of just a fun fact, but InSight is actually an acronym. I thought it was just a cool name because it sounds cool for space stuff.
Sure,
but
it is.
Stands for Interior Exploration Using Seismic Investigations, Geodesy, and Heat Transport. So essentially, it's going to be digging into the surface of Mars, doing some study on the the seismology, and I guess they're going to try to get an understanding of how the core is working, and it's supposed to kind of give us a better comprehension of how rocky planets formed, which also includes our rocky planet. So kind of a cool thing. But Monday, you know, you might have heard or seen some of these articles come on people's news feeds or whatever, that the quote-unquote 7 minutes of terror that are going to happen on Monday, and I guess that's the 7 to 8 minutes it takes for the rocket to actually make entry and actually land.
When it can crash and shit.
Yeah, and so we won't really know 100% whether all's good for 7 minutes, 7 to 8 minutes.
Science is weird, dude. We were able to, you know, track it for 6 months and 300 million miles, but once it gets there, there's like 7 or 8 minutes where we're just fucked. You know, because we just can't hear shit. That's just so weird.
Well, the way it works is, it's so far away. It's an 8 minute communication lag between Mars and Earth, right? Mm. And if you're an avid sci-fi fan, you would know that because it's in some of our more contemporary sci-fi these days, like The Expanse. But which makes communication, and obviously it would make manual control of a landing very, very difficult.
Yeah.
And so everything about this landing is completely pre-programmed, and it has to all go very, very specifically according to plan. Otherwise, shit can go haywire and it's going to crash land. But the coolest thing about this is Wired, the outlet Wired, will be broadcasting the entire event live online. And there's even local events happening, even in our own Seattle area, the Pacific Science Center on Monday. They're going to have a whole live event following the whole thing. They're going to have live feeds from the control rooms, and I don't know if there's going to be any visual stuff. I'm kind of hoping so, but I doubt it.
That's kind of cool.
But yeah, it's pretty cool. I'm a sucker for all this real life sci-fi stuff, so I wanted to bring that into my grab bag. Did you have any pop culture news before we get to sports?
I don't think news. I watched The Incredibles 2.
Mm.
It was fucking really good. Incredibles 2 was awesome.
So is that out on video now?
It is. Yeah, we watched it on Amazon.
Okay, because I really want to watch that.
Yeah, we rented it for like $3. It was awesome. Incredibles 2 was totally worth $3. It was so good.
I can't wait. Yeah, because I'm going to rewatch the first one too, because I really loved the first one.
And then, babe, did we watch any other movies?
No.
I don't really think so.
It's Thanksgiving. It's a busy time.
Yeah, no, I talked about all those movies I watched last week when we were at Dave's. I think that's pretty much it. I did not really do that much.
Dang, I might have watched. This is like might be the first time I watched more movies than you.
Yeah.
I watched on Thanksgiving. After dinner, we watched the Jim Carrey, How the Grinch Stole Christmas, which is probably my favorite Christmas movie of all time.
Biscuit likes that movie a lot.
It's good. Like this. Good for Biscuit.
He quoted it during the Century Club. It's gold.
It's gold.
Yeah.
I love that movie. We watched that right after, kind of as we were having, we're all sitting there, you know, our pants are unbuckled and we're all dying because we ate too much food. And so for whatever reason, well, that's what I thought, but we determined since Thanksgiving dinner was officially over, Thanksgiving was over, so we could break into Christmas time. And so we watched that.
It's not even December yet.
This is true. But my Christmas tree is already up.
Really?
Mm-hmm. For reasons.
That's not good.
Well, the family was here, so we had to put it up and take some pictures. You know what I mean?
All right. Well, that makes sense.
But, yeah, we did that. We watched that. And then right after that, like, my mom went to bed and stuff. And me and my cousin and my brother, his girlfriend, and Carolina and I, it was only like, I don't know, 7 o'clock, 7:30. And everybody was just done from drinking all day and eating tons of food. But yeah, we put on the original Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh, okay.
Dude, I can't get over how much better that one is than the second one.
Yeah.
It's so much better.
Yes.
It was so good.
They're like the comedic outlet for the Marvel Universe.
Yeah.
I'm just not a huge fan of that. I mean, I guess that's kind of how they are in the comics. I never really read Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, me neither.
But
the first one, I think, had a much better balance between like serious action and comedy. Second one was just way too much comedy.
Way too much jokes.
Way too much.
Too many yucks.
Yeah. You know? Way too many. And I think it was because of Groot, little baby Groot.
Yeah.
Little baby Groot's just too hard to not have
and
fun
then
with.
Teenage Groot, you know?
Yeah.
Teenage Groot's kind of funny, though. He's just kind of like a prick.
Yeah. It's just this adolescent, like, leave me alone. I'm playing my video game.
Yeah. I'm Groot.
I'm Groot.
Really funny.
But the the day after Thanksgiving, because we stayed the night over at my mom's house, we came in and we watched Speed was on TV.
By the bus?
Yeah.
Okay.
The original Sandra Bullock, Dennis Hopper, you know, Keanu little baby Reeves. Face Keanu Reeves.
Yeah.
That movie's so awesome, though.
Yeah. So I've never seen that movie, but I know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Isn't that weird? I know that much about it.
You've never seen Speed?
I've never seen
it. Oh. Dude, Speed is a great movie.
See, we've seen Bob's Burgers.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that what it is, Bob's Burgers, where he makes the models and shit, and he has one that's the bus from Speed?
Probably.
Is that? I think that it's Bob's Burgers. He has, like, hella models and stuff that he does when he has his own free time, and one of them is the bus from Speed.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
That sounds really familiar. It's been a while since I watched Bob's Burgers.
I think that's what it is.
Especially since King of the Hill's on Hulu, and it's kind of taken over my life.
I like King of the Hill. I always did when it was on TV.
I've come to a determination now.
God damn it, Bobby.
King of the Hill, the main guy, I guess, is Hank Hill, right?
Yeah.
And when it comes to people that are like positive role models in entertainment or, you know, just Hollywood in general, just people in general, even, you know, you have people that are like good role models, right?
Yeah.
But no one is like 100% good role model.
Right.
Because we're all people. Hank Hill is like 75% a good role model.
He's up there. He's pretty good.
I think that's pretty good for people.
He made Bobby smoke a whole carton of cigarettes.
He did. Time. I just watched that episode last week.
I'll definitely do that with my kid. I smoked way too many cigarettes. Oh, you like cigarettes? Let's smoke a whole fucking carton of cigarettes. I'll drop $100 on a lesson. Let's do it.
Oh, make him sicker than crap.
Yeah, let's do it. He threw up right now in the yard. And then he made him hose it out of the yard, too.
Yeah. Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
So the last little bit of pop culture news. Yes. The rapper Tekashi 6ix9ine.
Yeah.
Brother's going to jail.
He had a video of like a 13-year-old blowing a guy.
Yeah, that was earlier. This is the latest.
Tell me about.
Yeah, this is the latest and greatest. He's now in federal custody on racketeering and firearm charges.
What?
Yeah.
On some Lil Wayne shit?
Yeah. Law enforcement also arrested his associates, Kifano Jordan, a.k.a. Shooty. Shoddy. And then also his other guy, Ish and Crippy?
Word.
Either way. So but they're stupid. They're all going down.
Those are all dumb fucking names for what they do.
It's all connected to the racketeering and firearms charges. Mm. The details of the arrest are not clear at this time, but brother going away. Brother going away.
That's good.
Just don't get into that crap, man.
You're fucking 13-year-olds. So.
Yeah. Yeah, that... Because as I was reading it, because I don't know anything about this guy.
I hate all this new shit, these motherfuckers.
Yeah, and so I started reading it, and it was like, you get down to the article, and it's like, then it starts talking about all this other stuff he did before. You're like, oh, this guy's just a straight piece of garbage.
Yeah.
So that's my little, you know, contribute to pop culture in the rap world.
No, I don't like all these new fucking weird people like Tekashi 6ix9ine, and there's like a kid named Lil Xan or some shit, and I don't like that. You know, babe, what are some other these new weird people? Can't think of any of their names off the top of your head? No?
Nope.
Well, people like that. I'm not a...
Yeah. I mean, just don't hate on Lil Yachty.
I like Lil Yachty.
I like Lil Yachty.
I do. Tidal calls him Lil Yachty.
Lil Yachty. Come on, Tidal. Get a little so class stupid. There, buddy. You know what a yacht is.
They have all kinds of... You know what a yacht is. Oh, my God. So gold.
I just had
That's
to.
Funny.
Oh, I'm sorry, Tidal.
You
I love you, man.
You know what a yacht is.
I just...
That's... Oh, my God. That's gold. That's a good one.
You just can't softball them in like that, bro.
I hope Tidal listens to this. Me that too. Was gold. I like that a lot.
I hope Tidal listens to this just because I like listeners.
So I only have a couple of things when it comes to sports. When I was sick, I forgot to do my pick'ems, like any of them. So I gave up on the pick'ems because I was behind, and now I'm
way
13
behind.
Games behind on top of that. So I stopped doing the pick'ems because there's no fucking way. But the Redskins, like you said, Alex Smith broke his motherfucking leg. And then they signed Mark Sanchez to be the backup for Colt McCoy. And so Colt McCoy started, and he went 24 for 38 for 268 yards, two teeters, and three interceptions, and then also had five rushes for 28 yards.
That's just ridiculous.
Yeah, so he did pretty all right. And then I got, oh my God, this is the weirdest thing of all, right?
Is it?
Joe Theismann.
Joe Theismann, yep. That's a weird name.
He used to be a quarterback, okay?
Okay.
So, Alex Smith, the day that he broke his leg, okay? Joe Theismann is in the audience watching this game, right? Happens 30 years to the day that Joe Theismann broke his leg in the exact same way.
Oh!
The exact same way. And I think I cannot say whether or not this is true, but something I heard, right? Both happened in the same spot on the field.
And, no, sir.
And the score was the same in both games when it happened.
I'm sorry. I have to pee so bad. I'm trying to. I just I think really Jordan trying.
He's in the bathroom.
Okay.
So you might have to
well,
wait.
Then we're good.
But that's it. And then the 49ers released Reuben Foster.
Okay.
He's a linebacker. I heard about some domestic violence shit, but that's all that I really know about that. And Alex Smith is out for the rest of the season with his leg.
Yeah, so. that doesn't bode well for me.
Yeah.
And it was such a busy week. I negated to find a second defense, so my defense also had a bye.
Oh, my God.
I'm hurting this week.
Yeah, getting your ass beat?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's all right. So Colin went to the bathroom. Nope, that's it. That's it. I know. Well, all I have is a line. Back. So, yeah.
I'm coming back.
That's all I have is a line, and then we can go.
Let's do it.
So, except for I didn't say this last week, Morgan. You're dead ass wrong about Riverdale. There's three seasons. The third one is on TV right now, not two seasons. Jordan will slap you if she ever hears you talk bad about Riverdale ever again.
Ooh, the gauntlet has been thrown.
And the cat from Sabrina, its name is Salem. Okay. You should know that shit. And if you didn't know it, you should have looked it up.
Oh, she was on the spot. Give her a break now. It's a lot of pressure being on the cast.
I feel like if anybody...
You got big shoes to fill,
if
bro.
If anybody should know the name of Salem, I expected her to know it. You know, it seems weird to me that she didn't know that his name was Salem. Just because of the stuff that she's into, Boy Meets World and all the whatnot, you know, that seems like right up her alley.
Word.
But and I think she did say Salem, but then was like, is it this? Like, I'm pretty sure she said, I'm pretty sure his name is Salem, but then was like, oh, wait, but is this his name? And just wasn't for certain.
Word.
So... Anyway, so the line that I have for you this week, so you can go pee when we're done,
is about to pop off.
Just go ahead, you know, Colin, just get in your van and go, okay? Because I'll throw down. I'll throw down any day of the week. All right, get in your little van and drive out of my face right before I go America all over your ass.
That's okay. I'll just pee on your ass.